So first we look a bit in the hardware capabilities. So let's understand the characteristics of a big data cluster. So we typically buy commodity components. That means they are rather cheap and standardized. You can buy them to the thousands, and they provide an interconnect, so a network interface that is on board, and they have typically local storage provided. So that means inside a single computer, like with your laptop. So with them, we build kind of a, can build a topology, which we have seen with Hadoop already. So we have a rack. Inside the rack, we have our nodes that have storage, multiple storage devices potentially. And they are connected with a fast switch inside the rack. And then we have a slower connection outside of the switch to a global kind of backbone switch of a tree topology, and again connecting to additional racks. So now we can look a little bit into the performance values. So from one node to the switch, we could have, for example, a gigabit Ethernet, which provides 1 gigabit or about 125 megabytes a second as throughput. Nowadays, more common is 10 gigabit Ethernet already, but for the sake of simplicity, I use here this low value. So this switch here that we have inside the rack may provide a bandwidth, for example, of 48 gigabit. So that means we can connect 48 nodes here inside the rack, and still each of the nodes is able to get the full performance of 1 gigabit. But if we would have, I don't know, 64 nodes, we can't communicate at the same time with all of them. Otherwise, our performance drops to 48 gigabit. Okay, now once we leave the rack to this top level switch, we would see that the performance drops because the number of connections between those switches will be lower. Here in this example, it's about 10 gigabit. So that means rack-to-rack communication is limited here by 10 gigabit per second. So up to 10 nodes, so 5 nodes from here can communicate with 5 nodes from here. And then another 5 nodes from here could communicate, for example, with another rack. Then you are satisfied and kind of utilize the available network bandwidth. So in contrast, the HPC cluster characteristics, what we find is that they are not commodity components, but high-end components. They have extremely fast interconnects because that matters for tightly coupled applications that we have in HPC, as you will see. And we also have a global and shared storage with dedicated servers. So the nodes are connected to a switch, and for example, they could get something like 56 gigabit per second, conservatively, and the switch would manage to get 24 terabit, and then we have a faster switch, for example, at the top level that connects the different racks together. And typically, you not only have one switch, but multiple, and they form a topology that provides nearly, or at best, full bisection bandwidth. There are various topologies available. Unfortunately, I have not the time to talk about topologies in this lecture, but please check it out. HPC topologies are highly interesting. So here on the bottom, we have another switch that connects kind of these storage servers that are connected as well, and they may be connected to a storage area network. So in terms of throughput, so certainly we get higher throughput here out of it, but also what you will find is that the latency in this case, it's much lower compared to a Ethernet-based network where you have in the area of 120 microseconds, which is about 0.1 milliseconds latency. So now that we talked a bit about the general organization, let's talk about hardware performance in general. So in terms of computation, well, you can think about that you have a certain frequency in your machine, you have a certain number of cores and a number of sockets, which means the number of microprocessors. And when you multiply all of them, you get a number of cycles per second that are processed on this single node. Of course, what kind of operation you can do per cycle depends on the kind of instruction you are doing. Let's assume we can do about 60 gigacycles per second of instructions, which is quite an interesting assumption. So then we can think a bit about memory, which is needed for computation, which can be thought about like the throughput of a DDR4 DIMM times the number of channels. So you can get, for example, easily 25.6 gigabyte per second times 3 channels, so 75 gigabyte a second. So with the network, we talked about the throughput already, 125 megabyte with gigabit Ethernet, and latencies in 0.1 milliseconds with gigabit again, only slightly higher if you run with 10 gigabit Ethernet. It's much better when you use technology from HPC. For example, with InfiniBand, you can get in a couple of nanoseconds a latency. So finally, we have input-output devices. So their performance pretty much depend on the mechanical structure that you have. So if you would use an HDD hard disk drive, well, which is, I think, pretty much outdated nowadays, you have to pay, for example, 7 milliseconds of time to search from one position on the disk to another position on the disk, which is very expensive. So random access must be prevented. If you would access it sequentially, you would get 150 megabytes a second. But once you go down to a couple of kilobyte, maybe the performance goes down to megabytes a second or even less. Nowadays, we have, of course, SSDs and then non-volatile memory, but they come with their own latency and throughput. You can think of them a little bit more in the area of a gigabit Ethernet network in terms of their performance characteristics. So now talk a bit, little bit about the hardware strategies, the hardware-aware strategies that you do inside your software solutions to make them work better. Let's first talk a little bit about Java. So Java, in terms of efficiency, is generally a bit suboptimal. That means you need about 2 times the number of cycles than C. There are various studies around that. It can go down to 1.2. So that means you need 20% more cycles than in C. So you waste a little bit of performance. But that is on the level of a node. Now, what plays an important role is that you want to utilize different hardware components concurrently. So you want to, for example, compute, do I/O, and communicate at the same time. If all of them, three of them, take the same amount of time, then you can hide two of them, right? So you have A, B, and C, compute, I/O, and communication, if you do that in sequence, right? And now what happens if you put all the three at the same time? You get a 3 times speed up versus sequential, which is quite nice. So we all have to avoid barriers and have basically asynchronous operations. Next is that we have to balance and distribute our workload among all available servers. So in that sense, the scalability of the hardware and software solution is important. At best, you get a linear scalability. So if you add 10 times the number of servers, you would want that it's 10 times as fast. Typically, that means that you don't get 10 times as fast in terms of time, but it means that you can process 10 times the amount of data, for example, in the same time. That would scale very well. We talk here about weak scaling, more about that in the second part of the lecture. So what you like to do is that you want to monitor the components to see the utilization. So how much of our available network throughput is utilized. Of course, the higher we utilize our system, the better we make use of what we have paid for. We should avoid I/O if possible and keep the data in memory. And we should avoid communication if possible, but sometimes it isn't. So when you think about the data flow languages that we learned last week about, you can easily exploit their semantics. When you have, for example, for each and filter operations, these are pretty much node local operations. You don't need to communicate at all. When you talk about sorting, grouping, and joining, well, you need to communicate between the nodes, and then we have some kind of communication. So that is really a quick primer into some considerations for hardware that I could stuff in this lecture.